Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Africans and Native Americans, The Language of Race and the Evolution of Red-Black Peoples by Jack D. Forbes. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. Thousands of volumes have been written about the historical and social relations existing between Europeans and the native peoples of the Americas and between Europeans and Africans, but relations between Native Americans and Africans have been sadly neglected. The entire Afro-Native American cultural exchange and contact experience is a fascinating and significant subject, but one largely obscured by a focus upon European activity and European colonial relations with peripheral subject peoples. Africans and Americans must now be studied together without their relations always having to be obscured by the separations established through the work of scholars focusing essentially upon some aspect of European expansion and colonialism. It is especially important to note here, at the very beginning of the study, that those relations do not begin only in the Americas. On the contrary, they also take place in Europe and in Africa, and perhaps also in the Pacific. Contacts in Europe can be seen as significant because both the African and Native American ancestry there has tended to be absorbed into the general European society, and whatever earlier cultural developments have occurred have now become part of modern European culture. The impact of non-European peoples upon European societies directly within Europe has not, as of yet, been fully explored. And, of course, there is now a large new group of Native Americans and people of African background in Europe. Contacts in the Americas have been studied to some extent, but much work remains to be done. Contacts in Africa have been studied very little. The fact of a relatively small but steady American presence in Africa from at least the early 1500s onward may well prove to be a vital area for future research, since one would expect to find Native American cultural influences in regions such as Angola, Zaire and Ghana, Guinea, Cape Verde especially. It is, of course, interesting to note that some Africans were already exposed to American cultural influences before leaving Africa. The cultures brought by Africans to the Americas may already have been influenced, especially by Brazilian Native Americans. The extent of such cultural exchange will obviously have to be worked out in careful field research in Angola, Ghana, Guinea, Cabo Verde, and other places, as well as in archival records. This study has a modest objective, in that it seeks to introduce the subject and to primarily deal with a series of basic issues or questions which have to be resolved before proceeding to a detailed analysis of the precise nature of African-American relations. Raymond Williams, in Key Words, 1976, has shown the importance of confronting the issue of meaning as a fundamental aspect of scholarship. I propose to apply his example to the basic terms which inform our understanding of African-American contact and mixture, terms which are part of a nomenclature developed under colonialism and racism. Long ago, when first working with my own Powhatan Renape people of Virginia, Maryland, Delaware, and surrounding areas, I discovered that the meaning of racial terms was a controversial issue. I learned that terms such as mulatto and colored were used, or had been used, in Virginia in quite a different way from their usage in most books, including modern dictionaries. I also discovered that many questions were not answerable within the context of the latter, such as, what do you call a person of mixed American, European, and African ancestry? No one provided any answer, because it seems the American mixture with the African was generally subordinated to a focus upon, or fascination with, only the black-white nexus. The modern dictionaries all stated that a mulatto was the child of a black and a white, or someone of mixed black and white ancestry. But where did that leave those who were also part Indian? In any case, I discovered that Native American descendants had been legally defined as mulattoes in Virginia in 1705, without having any African ancestry. Thus I knew that the dictionaries were wrong and that there was a lot that was hidden from view by the way most authors had written about the southern United States, about slavery, and about colored people. I later discovered also that the same thing was true as regards the Caribbean, Brazilian, and much of the rest of the Americas. The unraveling of misconceptions is almost as important as the creation of new conceptions, it would seem, and this is nowhere more true than in the realm of race relations. So, before one can seriously reconstruct Black African Native American contacts, one must clear away a lot of mistakes arising out of the very nature of discourse in a racist colonial setting, as well as mistakes arising from the assumption that the current meanings assigned to racial terms have an equal validity for the past. As the listener will find out, there is hardly a racial term which has a clear and consistent meaning over time and space. For example, the term Indian, or Indio, has been applied to many peoples, including the Indians of South Asia, as well as all groups found in the West Indies, the Americas, and the East Indies, Filipinos, Chinese, Japanese, etc. The term Negro has been applied to Black Africans, the Indians of India, Native Americans, Japanese, and slaves of whatever ancestry. Black has been used for all of the above and for non-whites in general. By way of illustration, in attempting to grapple with the problem of Black African Native American mixture, and especially with the question of to what extent African Americans throughout the Americas are part American Indian, it is first necessary to focus upon a clarification of such racial or ethnic terms as were used in the colonial and early national periods. Key terms include mulatto, pardo, colored, free colored, negro, zambo, or Sambo, Musty, and Mestizo. As noted, many modern writers, whether popular or scholarly, have simply assumed they could transfer 16th, 17th, or 18th century racial terms to contemporary usage without any critical examination of meaning. For example, it has been assumed generally that a mulatto of, let us say, 1600 would be of the same racial background as a mulatto of 1865 or of 1900, or that a colored person of 1830 would be the same as a colored person of 1930. Moreover, it has also been assumed that terms such as free Negro and free colored can be used interchangeably, and that one could, in more recent usage, substitute free Black for either of these. Many prominent writers have, it seems, been very lax in their failure to consider that the meaning of a word is never a timeless, eternal constant, but rather as a constantly evolving, changing pointer. Thus, the word coach, as used in the 19th century, stagecoach or other horse-drawn vehicle, then later a railway coach, has today become something different, for example, motor coach. And while we can trace the obvious connection between stagecoach, railway coach, and motor coach, it is still quite clear that we would be badly mistaken to interpret get on the coach of 1840, for example, as meaning get on the bus of 1960. And of course, the term coach has other meanings today, aside from motor coach. We may think we know what the word Negro means today, but do we know what it meant in 1800 in Virginia? And did it mean the same as colored? The answer to these questions is not and cannot be an exercise in deductive logic or a priori reasoning. It is, rather, an empirical problem which can only be solved by discovering through documentary and other evidence exactly how such terms were used. This is not an easy task, for reasons which will become clearer later. In short, we cannot move, historiographically, from word to word or concept to concept across the centuries. We must instead actually engage the primary data in order to touch reality. When we discover that one of Sir Francis Drake's pilots, not an airline pilot, incidentally, in 1595 was Isileño de Nación Mulato and sailed from Plymouth, England, through being an islander in origin, we should not picture him as if he were a mulatto of 1981 or of 1900. His precise racial background is not established by the use of the term mulatto, as we shall see. We must ascertain from other evidence, if we can, what the Spanish author meant by his usage of this category. During the summer of 1981, newspapers in the United States carried stories about blacks rioting in British cities. What they failed to tell their readers was that in Britain today the term black is applied not only to Africans or West Indians, of whatever shade or mixture, but also to people from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and even to Latin Americans. For example, a very light-skinned Chilean lady refugee living in Oxford was surprised to be referred to as a black. Her dark hair, Spanish accent, and immigrant status had caused her to become black, at least to some English contacts. I have before me an appeal to drop all charges against black youth, which refers to the arrest of some young Asians in Bradford during the summer of 1981. This modern British usage, which usage extends well back into earlier years, reflects very vividly the problem of assuming that English terms such as black, Negro, mulatto, or colored can be interpreted easily when found in documents of earlier eras. When the Europeans first established intensive contacts with Africans and part Africans, they met people with a great variety of physical characteristics. This was especially true in the Iberian Peninsula and Mediterranean area, but undoubtedly many of the Moors and Blackamoors who came to England in Shakespeare's day were of North African as well as Sub-Saharan background and from many distinct nations. Later in the 16th and 17th centuries, diversity was also encountered, as when most English vessels sailing to the Caribbean dropped anchor at the Cabo Verde Islands. One writer in 1647 commented on the extreme variability of physical types met there and the great beauty of the mixed Cabo Verde women. We must realize, therefore, that at the very beginning of the modern period, racial terms as used by Iberians and as acquired by the English were going to refer to part African peoples who might not only have the features of the Gulf of Guinea, variable as they are, but also every conceivable combination of Central African, Ibero-African, Afro-Arabic, and American-African mixtures. And for our purposes, it is important to stress that many Africans from the Sahel or Savannah belt, Hausa, etc., as well as from parts of East Africa, sometimes resemble American-African hybrids, with various combinations of high cheekbones, prominent aquiline noses, semi-wavy or bushy hair, oriental eye shapes, etc. Why is this important? Simply because many part American, part African persons with no European ancestry could easily be subsumed under a racial term applicable to pure blood Africans and would not, in any case, be especially recognizable to most observers as being part American. The predominant physical type of the slaves brought in from Africa may have been that of coastal West Africa, but enough variability existed so that terms such as blackamoor, negro, and black cannot a priori be assumed to be useful for determining precise genetic identity. Many color terms, such as dark, swarthy, and brown, are also quite ambiguous, as should be obvious. In a 1756 list of militiamen in King and Queen County, Virginia, for example, one finds, in addition to fair-complexioned persons, Thomas Delaney as dark, Benjamin Wilson as dark, James Willimore as brown, John Major as brown, John Kemp as swarthy, but with light hair and freckles, John Evans as dark, and Richard Riddle as dark. All or most of these men were born in Virginia, and several were planters. Were they part American or part African? Certainly, we cannot judge their race from such color reference alone. Similarly, in 1768, an advertisement appeared in New Jersey for an apprentice lad named John Foster, born in the Jerseys, about 5 feet 8 inches high, of a dark complexion, and pitted with the smallpox, wears his hair with a false cue to it. In any case, the colonial and state courts in the United States frequently had difficulty in determining exact racial status. In 1859, a North Carolina court called in a planter as an expert who could distinguish between the descendants of a Negro and a white person and the descendants of a Negro and an Indian. He could also, allegedly, differentiate between a pure African and a white cross or an Indian cross. Unfortunately, most of us today lack that kind of certain expertise, whatever phenotypical features are seized upon as evidence providing proof. In our efforts to reconstruct the story of Black African Native American relations, it is necessary then to begin with an analysis of the evolution of the meaning of racial terms, for only in this way can we hope to identify people of American and African ancestry in the past. But the study of words alone does not, in fact, reveal the subtleties of actual usage. And thus I have had to delve into many aspects of Native American, Black African history in order to reconstruct the environments in which racial and color terms have evolved and been given a new or different content. The listener will find a great deal of the social and cultural history of Afro-Americans and Native Americans in this work, woven together with broad social history as it relates to colonialism, slavery, and racism. But the primary purpose of this study is not to write a comprehensive account of Native American-African relations, but rather to establish a sound empirical and conceptual basis for further study in this area, and more importantly, to demonstrate beyond any doubt that old assumptions must be set aside. This latter is especially true as regards the extent of Native American-African mixture and the significant genetic contribution of Americans to present-day Black or Afro-American populations in the Caribbean, Brazil, the United States, and elsewhere. This work will, I hope, make a major contribution to the field of the history of race relations and, more specifically, to the study of the formation of plantation, Creole, and colonial cultures in the Americas and elsewhere. Because of the data presented herein, a great deal of revision will have to be made in these areas, as well as in the fields studying the evolution of modern African, Afro-American, and Native American cultures. Finally, I hope that this study of inter-ethnic contact and racial classifying will lead to progress in the field of human rights by highlighting and clarifying a major area of abuse: the arbitrary and often racist practice of defining the identities of other human beings by powerful outsiders, as well as by governments and institutions. 1. Africans and Americans. Intercontinental Contacts Across the Atlantic, to 1500. Americans Crossing the Atlantic Before Columbus. The meeting of Native Americans and Africans, of people from two great continents of the earth, can be described in many ways. A fitting mode in which to begin is to cite a Native American story from Guyana, presented by Jan Kourou, in which Nian, an African sky spirit, along with the African Earth Mother, the African River Mother, and Anansi the Spider Trickster, met the Great Spirit, the Father Sun, and other spirit powers of the Americans. The next day, all the peoples of the earth complained to Father Sun, and for the first time, the ebony people who were neighbors of Tohono made themselves heard. The Great Spirit invited Nian, the anthracite-colored sky god, to share his domains. They, the African spirits, agreed on condition that the Great Spirit, in turn, shared the distant kingdoms of earth and sky that Nian ruled. Pia, an American child of the sun and of Tohono, the Mist Woman, became a brother to Anansi the Spider-Man, and both agreed to live among human beings. Thus, the spirit powers of the Black Africans are said to have established a close cooperative relationship with the spirit powers of the Americans. This same cooperation and reciprocal relationship can also be seen in Brazil, where Tupinambá and Guarani Candomblés exist side by side with those of Congo Angola and Nago orientation, and where Native American and African spiritual powers are called upon for assistance in various contexts. The dimensions of African American contact can also be seen in a painting by the Dutch artist Jan Steen, 1645, in which the making of a marriage contract in the Netherlands area is depicted. The future bridegroom is of African ancestry, while a man of American race is an active onlooker on the right-hand side of the scene. The bride is of European Dutch background. Thus, in spiritual as well as secular contexts, the American and African peoples have interacted with each other in a variety of settings and situations. These interactions may well have begun in very ancient times. J. A. Rogers, Leo Weiner, Ivan van Sertima, and others have cited evidence, including the Olmec stoneheads of Mexico, pointing towards early contacts between American and African cultures. I do not propose here to explore the early archaeological evidence, which, in essence, requires a separate study, but instead I will cite briefly some tantalizing data which suggests contacts in both directions. It is now well known that the Atlantic Ocean contains a series of powerful rivers or currents which can facilitate the movement of floating objects from the Americas to Europe and Africa, as well as from the latter to the Americas. In the North Atlantic, the most prominent current is that of the Gulf Stream, which swings through the Caribbean and then moves in a northeasterly direction from Florida to the Grand Banks off Terra Nova, Newfoundland, turning then eastwards towards the British Isles and the Bay of Biscay. This current has carried debris from Jamaica and the Caribbean to the Hebrides and Orkneys of Scotland. Moreover, Jean Marion tells us that valuable hardwood was commonly washed ashore along the coasts of Ireland and Wales. This timber from the ocean, borne by the Gulf Stream, really came from the rivers of Mexico. Marion, a student of transatlantic navigation by small vessels, also states that the first attempt, the first success, of crossing the Atlantic by one man could only come from the American side, because the crossing is much less difficult in that direction. A French writer has said, justly, in all probability, that if America had been the old world, its inhabitants would have discovered Europe long before we did, in fact, discover America. This is because of the prevailing winds from the west as well as the currents. One can, says Marion, sail in a straight line from Boston via Newfoundland to Ireland or Cornwall with almost the certainty of fair winds. The other direction requires twice the distance, thrice the time, and four times the sweat. In the 1860s, a 48-foot-long sloop, Alice, was navigated from North America to the Isle of Wight in less than 20 days with very favorable winds, and in recent times a wooden raft was propelled from Canada to Northern Europe by means of this ocean river. Moreover, Stephen C. Jett cites the 68-day passage of one William Verity from Florida to Ireland in a 12-foot sloop, as well as the crossing by two men from New York to the Scilly Islands in 55 days in a 17-foot dory powered only by oars. Thus, the Gulf Stream demonstrably can propel small craft successfully from the Americas to Europe. Perhaps this is the explanation behind the local Dutch tradition that holds that in AD 849, one Zurich arrived by boat to found the coastal city of Zurichsee, and why the local people believed that he had arrived in an Inuit, Greenland, kayak, which was on display there for several centuries. The kayak may, indeed, not have been Zurich's original craft, but it very possibly points toward a genuine folk tradition of a crossing of the Atlantic from the west. In this context, it is also worth noting a report that Columbus had information about strange people from the west who had reached Ireland prior to 1492, doubtless via the Gulf Stream. Marion tells us that Bartholomew or Christopher Columbus had made marginal notes in their copy of Pius II's Historia, 1477, to the effect that some men have come from Cathay by heading east. We have seen more than one remarkable thing, especially in Galway, in Ireland, two people tied to two wrecks, a man and a woman, a superb creature. Marion also believes that the first documented case of a single navigator crossing the Atlantic consists in the record of a Native American who reached the Iberian Peninsula long before Columbus's day. In the Middle Ages, there arrived one day on the coast of Spain a man red and strange in a craft described as a hollowed tree. From the recorded description, which specifically states that he was not a Negro, he might well have been a native of America in a piragua, a dugout canoe. The unfortunate man, ill and enfeebled, died before he had been taught to make himself understood. To return to our discussion of the Gulf Stream, it should be noted that this eastward flowing current has a southern extension which swings southwards along the west coast of Europe to the Iberian Peninsula and on to the Canary Islands. From the latter region it turns southwestwards and then westwards, returning to the Americas in the vicinity of Trinidad and rejoining the Caribbean segment of the Gulf Stream. Thus, it would be theoretically possible to float in a great circle from the Caribbean to Europe and northwestern Africa and then back to the Caribbean. A Native American archaeologist, E. F. Greenman, has argued that the crossing of the North Atlantic was feasible before the end of the Pleistocene period, about 11,000 years ago, for a people with kayaks and the beatuk type of canoe, from Newfoundland, if at that time the ocean was filled with floating ice from the Scandinavian and Labrador glaciers and from freezing of the sea itself. The same author attempts to show many parallels between Pleistocene European and American cultures, but sadly neglects African comparisons. In any case, his argument is based solely upon hypothetical European movements toward the Americas, movements which would have had to fight against the currents and winds rather than flowing with them. Bartolomé de las Casas, in his monumental Historia de las Indias, cites examples of rafts or canoes, almachias, dead Americans, and debris reaching the Azores Islands before 1492. This evidence will be discussed later. Here it is only necessary to note that the Azores lay in an area of weak currents, but that, even so, with the help of winds from the west and northwest, some boats could reach the islands from the Americas. In the South Atlantic, as noted, a strong current runs from the west coast of North Africa towards Trinidad. Below that, a countercurrent is sometimes shown, running eastwards from South America to the Gulf of Guinea. Then a strong current runs westwards from the mouth of the River Zaire, Congo, to the north of the Amazon, where it divides, part joining the northwesterly current which becomes the Gulf Stream and part swinging southwards along the coast of Brazil, until it veers eastwards across the Atlantic to Africa again, reaching southwestern Africa, from whence it curves northwards to rejoin the Zaire-Amazon current. Thus, as farther north, a great circle is formed. Fundamentally, what we see are two great circular rivers in the ocean, the northern circle running in a clockwise direction and the southern circle in a counterclockwise direction, with a smaller countercurrent in between, running eastwards. In the South Atlantic, Americans might have reached Africa via the countercurrent, or, more likely, via the Brazil to Southwest Africa current. Africans could have either used the southern, westwards swing of the North Atlantic circle, or the northern, also westwards swing of the South Atlantic circle, coming from the Sierra Leone-Senegal region or the Congo-Angola region respectively. Of course, one of the problems with the argument for early transatlantic crossings is that in the modern period such islands as Iceland, Bermuda, the Azores, the Madeiras, the Cabo Verdes, Tristan da Cunha, Ascension, and even São Tomé, off Nigeria and Cameroon, were uninhabited prior to documented Irish, Norse, and Portuguese occupations. On the other hand, some of these islands are small or far from major currents. Bartolomé de las Casas states that the Azores were the Islas Casitarides, mentioned by Strabo in his geography, and which islands were repeatedly visited by the Carthaginians. Allegedly, there lived in the Azores a people who wore loru or basso color, that is to say, people of the color of Native Americans or intermediate between white and black. The Canary Islands were inhabited in the 15th century by a people who were isolated from nearby Africa and whose cultures somewhat resembled those of some Americans. Moreover, the personal names of the many Canarios enslaved by the Spanish have a decidedly American ring about them, although such resemblances do not always mean a great deal. The Canarios are sometimes described as a loru, or brownish-colored people in the slave registers. The fact that the islands of Cabo Verde and Madeira were inhabited in the 15th century does indeed pose a problem for African navigation to the Americas. However, that will be discussed later. Now it is necessary to consider briefly evidence relating to the maritime capabilities of Americans in the late 15th century to see whether voyages across the Atlantic might have been feasible. The Americans of the Caribbean region were outstanding navigators and seamen, as noted by the Spaniards and other Europeans. Christopher Columbus was impressed everywhere by their skill. He noted, for example, that their boats, barcos y barquillos, which they call canoas, were excellently made from a single tree, were very large and long, carrying sometimes 40 or 45 men, two or more codos, perhaps a man's breadth, in width. The American boats were unsinkable, and if in a storm they happened to capsize, the sailors simply turned them back over while swimming in the sea, bailing them out with gourds carried for that purpose. Andres Bernaldez recorded from Columbus that the Americans navigated in their canoas with exceptional agility and speed, with 60 to 80 men in them, each with an oar, and they went by sea 150 leagues or more. They were masters of the sea. A canoe was later discovered in Jamaica, which was 96 feet long, 8 feet broad, made from a single tree. Columbus found that the Lucayo people of the Bahamas were not only very well acquainted with Cuba, 1.5 days away via canoe, but also knew from Cuba that it was a 10 days journey to the mainland, doubtless Mexico or South America, since Florida would have been closer than that. He also saw a boat which was 95 palms long, in which 150 persons could be contained and navigate. Others were seen which were of great workmanship and beauty, being expertly carved. A canoe was also seen being navigated successfully by one man in high winds and rough sea. In Haiti, Columbus learned that that island, or Jamaica, was 10 days' journey distant from the mainland and that the people there were clothed, thus referring to Mexico or Yucatan most likely. In another place he learned of a land, 100 leagues away, where gold was mined. The Arawak and Carib-speaking peoples of the Caribbean were well informed geographically. Columbus captured Caribs in the Antilles, such as Guadeloupe, from whom he learned of the South American mainland, but he also learned of the mainland from Americans living on St. Croix and Borinquen, Puerto Rico. Americans who were taken into Europe drew maps there which showed Haiti, Cuba, and the Bahamas, as well as many other islands and countries which were named in the native language. It seems quite clear that the geography of the Caribbean basin and the Bahamas, including that of the adjacent mainland, was accurately known to the Americans. Moreover, it seems clear that voyages of 60 to 150 leagues were undertaken, about 180 to 450 miles, figured conservatively at 3 miles per league, although the Spanish Nautical League often exceeded that distance. When Spaniards reached the area of Yucatan in 1517 and again in 1518, they found that the Maya people were already aware of what had transpired on the islands invaded earlier by the Europeans. The Maya were uniformly hostile, and at Campeche, they then made signs with their hands to find out whether we came from the direction of the sunrise, repeating the word Castillan, Castillan, and we did not understand what they meant by Castillan. In the latter year, the Spaniards met an American woman from Jamaica on the island of Cozumel. She told them that 2 years earlier she had started from Jamaica with 10 Indians in a large canoe intending to go and fish near some small islands, and that the currents had carried them over to this island where they had been driven ashore, and that her husband and all the Jamaica Indians had been killed and sacrificed. It seems more likely that the Jamaicans had fled from their home to avoid Spanish slave raiders and that they did not want to fall under European control. Hence her story. In any case, all of the Maya towns along the coast in 1517 were well aware of the threat posed by the Spaniards. This news could have been conveyed by 2 Spaniards living among them, but whatever the source, the news had spread very widely. Even more significant, for our purposes, is the fact that when the Spaniards reached Yucatan in 1517, they saw 10 large canoes, called piraguas, full of Indians from the town, approaching us with oars and sails. The canoes were large ones, made like hollow troughs, cleverly cut out from huge single logs, and many of them would hold 40 Indians. The fact that these boats were equipped with sails is indeed interesting, because it means that wind power could be used to run against currents or to navigate rapidly even when currents were lacking. Clinton R. Edwards also cites other evidence documenting the use of sails by Carib and other American peoples in the Caribbean and by Ecuadorian North Peruvian sailors in the Pacific, both at the time of initial Spanish contact. As an example of the navigational capabilities of the Caribbean natives, we can cite the case in 1516 when 70 or 80 Spaniards in a caravel and a bergantine brig sailed from Santiago de Cuba to the Guanaxa Islands off Honduras, now Roatan. There they enslaved many Guanaxa people and carried them in the caravel to Havana, Cuba. The Americans were subsequently able to overcome their Spanish guards, seizing the sailing ship, y haciendo sola vela, cual si fueran expertos navegantes, volvieron a su patria que distaba más de 200 leguas. In short, the Americans were such expert navigators that they were able to sail from Havana to Honduras, a distance of more than 200 leagues in a European vessel with no assistance from any non-Americans, and this after having been kept below decks during their journey to Havana. The navigational capabilities of the Americans of the Caribbean-Mexican coastal area extend back well into pre-Columbian times, as attested to by pictures of boats found in various codices, murals, and sculptured walls in the Mexico-Yucatan region. In about the 10th century AD, also the Mexican leader Quetzalcoatl is recorded as having sailed with a raft to the east, rising sun, from the Gulf Coast of central Mexico. Along the Atlantic coast of North America, Americans also went out to sea. On the South Carolina coast, for example, the Seawe outfitted boats with sails, and on one occasion a group of natives decided to visit England. They outfitted a canoe with sails and went out into the Atlantic, but were picked up by a British vessel and sold as slaves. In 1524, Verrazano saw dugout boats outside Chesapeake Bay, which were 20 feet long, while canoes were seen in Narragansett Bay, going out to sea with 14 or 15 men in them. One report of a later date states that Americans navigated between New Jersey and Chesapeake Bay, using canoes specially fitted out with sails and decks. But when they want to go a distance over the sea, as for instance to Virginia or New Holland, then they fasten two punts, canoes, dugouts together broadwise with timbers over them, right strongly put together, the deck made completely tight and sideboard of planks, sails of rugs and freze, cloth joined together, ropes and tackle made of bast and slender spruce roots, and they also mason for themselves a little fireplace on deck. To the south, along the Brazilian coast, the Portuguese and other Europeans also witnessed American navigation at sea. An Italian traveling with Magellan in 1519 noted that the Brazilians' boats were made from the trunk of a tree and were so large that each boat held 30 to 40 men. In the 1550s, Hans Staden noted that the dugout boats of the Santos Rio de Janeiro area could hold up to 30 men, were 4 feet in width, with some being larger and some smaller. In these, they move rapidly with oars, navigating with them as far as they wish. When the sea is rough, they take the canoes ashore until good weather comes again. They do not go more than 2 leagues straight out to sea, but along the coast they navigate far. In 1565, the Jesuit José de Anchieta stated that the Americans of the same region had dozens or more canoas made from a single tree, with other pieces of the same cutting used as boards well attached with vines. They were large enough to carry 20 to 25 persons with their arms and supplies, and some held up to 30 persons. With these boats, they were able to cross such fierce, bravas seas that it is a frightful thing and not to be imagined or believed without seeing. Anchieta also noted that if the canoes turned over, the navigators simply bailed out the boat, turned it right side up, and carried on. Thus, the Brazilian boats were also very well made, were very fast and maneuverable, and could be righted at sea if necessary. They were used to carry warriors and supplies over considerable distances along the coast, as, for example, from Santos, São Vicente, to Rio de Janeiro. In general, it would appear that the Americans of the Caribbean built the biggest boats and were most accustomed to going far out to sea, while the Atlantic coastal groups were more oriented to staying within a certain distance of land, 6 miles or so. On the other hand, all were capable of being carried out to sea by strong winds and currents and yet surviving rough water. It should also be noted that several groups along the Pacific coast manufactured seaworthy craft and were capable of reaching Polynesia by means of favorable currents. It is beyond the scope of this study to discuss such voyages, but one must note that many Pacific Island peoples may very well be of American ancestry mixed with varying proportions of Oceanic Negroid, African, and Malayo-Indonesian stocks. Returning to the Atlantic, it is interesting to note that there is some additional evidence to support the notion that Americans crossed in an easterly direction. For example, Pliny, in his Natural History, reported that Nepos de septentrionale circuiti tradit quinto metello celeri, Afranian consulatu colagae septum Galliae pro consuli, Indus erege suaborum dono datos, que ex India comerci, causo navigantes, tempestatibus sessent in Germanium abrupti. Thus we learn that Cornelius Nepos, an author of several works in the last century BC, and virtually a contemporary observer, recorded that as to the northern circuit of the seas from France northwards, that Quintus Metellus Celer, a colleague of Afranius in the consulship of Rome, but at the time proconsul of Gaul, south of the Alps, received from the Siwi king a present of Indians who on a trade voyage had been carried off their course by storms to Germany. In order to interpret this event, which occurred about 60 BC, we must keep in mind that for Pliny, Germany commenced far to the south of Denmark, that is in the Belgium-Netherlands region most likely. Pliny states that in the time of Augustus, Germanium classe circumfecta at Cimbrorum promontorium, a fleet sailed around Germany to the promontory of the Cimbri in Denmark. Also, Pliny believed that the Indus had reached a Germanic-speaking zone by way of a fictitious sea, which was thought by him to have connected India with the Baltic. We know, however, that the only way that people looking like Indians could have been driven by a storm to northern Europe would have been across the Atlantic from America. It should also be noted that the Siwi group of Germanic-speaking tribes is thought by some to have included the Angles, a people living at a later date along the North Sea shore of Germany. Several later writers, citing the Nepos account, assumed that the Indians were driven across the Atlantic. Certainly, there is no reason to doubt that the builders of Teotihuacan and the Olmecs were enraged in widespread trade or that they possessed navigational capabilities, to mention only two American groups active in the 60 BC time period. Archaeological evidence may also support later eastbound voyages, since Inuit, Eskimo-type harpoon heads have been found at two locations in Ireland and Scotland. For example, a harpoon head of very worn condition was found in County Down, Ireland, of which it is absolutely certain that it is of archaic Eskimo origin. Specifically, this harpoon head is of Thule type, dated probably between the 10th and 13th centuries. It was very unlikely to have been carried to Ireland by a seal or a walrus, and most likely was taken there by a living Inuit hunter, perhaps on a Norse vessel. The authors of the report on this find state that, so far, no harpoon head of the Mesolithic period has been recovered from Ireland, and the present specimen has no parallels among prehistoric European finds. The harpoon head found in Scotland may be of old Thule type and is perhaps earlier in date than the Irish discovery. It was found before 1876 in Aberdeenshire, in sandy ground. Inuit navigation will be discussed later, but here it is worth noting that the Amangsalik people of East Greenland in the 18th century used umiaks to journey all the way around the southern tip of Greenland to barter on the west coast. Often they did not beach the umiaks, but moored them in the water, having no need to dry them out. Such boats might have survived the kind of strong easterly winds which in 1347 drove a small Norse boat all the way from Markland, Labrador, to Iceland. Las Casas and other writers report that Columbus knew before his 1492 voyage of Americas reaching the Azores, along with reeds, pine trees, and other debris driven by westerly and northwesterly winds, certain Azorican settlers had told him that the sea had tossed up on the island of Las Flores the bodies of two dead persons, who seemed to have very wide faces and features unlike those of Christians. Moreover, on another occasion, it was said that in Cabo de la Verga and its vicinity, almagias, or canoes, were seen outfitted with a sort of house. These canoes were driven from place to place or island to island by the force of winds, and the occupants had apparently perished or disappeared while the vessels drifted for a time in the Azores region. Also, it was known that a Portuguese pilot had seen an ingeniously carved piece of wood some 450 leagues to the west of Portugal, which wood was being driven from the west and had not been carved with iron tools. Africans crossing the Atlantic before Columbus. Columbus was also aware that Africans may well have utilized ocean currents to navigate to the Americas. His 1498 voyage specifically used the southern route from the Cabo Verde Islands to Trinidad, an easy crossing traveled consistently thereafter by Spaniards, Portuguese, Britons, and others. Columbus was especially intrigued to see what lands lay in the South American direction, since the King of Portugal had said that there was Tierra Firme in that direction, and was greatly inclined to make discoveries to the southwest, y que se habían hallado canoas que salían de la costa de Guinea, que navegaban el oeste con mercaderías. In short, the Portuguese had found boats, canoas, which left from West Africa to navigate to the west with merchandise. In the Gulf of Paria area, near Trinidad, Columbus found that the Americans trajeron panzuelos de algodón muy labrados y tejidos, con colores y labores como los llevan de Guinea, de los ríos a la Sierra Leone, sin diferencia, y dice que no deben comunicar con aquellos, porque he de aquí donde el agora está, más de 800 leguas. Abajo dice que parecen almesares. Thus he saw well-made multicolored scarves or sashes identical with those of Sierra Leone, but because of the distance, he thought that the two peoples ought not to be in communication. Later, Columbus stated that each American wore scarves which resembled almesares, Moorish sashes, one for the head and one for the rest of the body. Nonetheless, one of Columbus's motives in examining the area around Trinidad was to experimentar lo que decían los indios desta Española, que había venido a ella de la parte del astro y del suesta gente negra, y que trae los hierros de las azagayas de un metal a que llaman guanen, de lo cual había enviado a los reos heche el ensay, donde se halló que dan triente y dos pantes, las 10 y 8 eran de oro y las 6 de plata y las 8 de cobre. Thus, Columbus wanted to verify the truth of what the Americans of Haiti had stated previously, to the effect that black people had come from the south and southeast, and that their azagaya, spear, heads were made of guanin, a brass or bronze-like mixture of gold, silver, and copper. Las Casas doubted the truth of one of Columbus's stories about an island with only women. Como le caiki dice que entendía haber isla que llamaba guanin donde había mucho oro, y no era sino que había en alguno parte guanin mucho, y esto era cierto especio de oro bajo que llamaban guanin, que es algo morado, el cual cognizan por el oro y estimanlo en mucho. Thus, the existence of an island of guanin where much gold was to be found was also doubted. Probably in some region there was much guanin, which was a base type of gold, oro, somewhat purplish, morado, esteemed much by the Americans and known by its smell. Significantly, the Americans of the Gulf of Paria area possessed pieces of gold, but it was muy bajo, que parecía sobre dorado, very low grade, appearing to be alloyed with or gilded over silver or base metal. No evidence of black people was found in the Trinidad Paria region, the Americans being either of Indio color or near white, many being tan blancos como nuestros y mayores cabellos y bien cortados, as white as us and better hair, well cut. Thus it seems likely that guanin was a base alloy or gilding of gold which was quite common in the Caribbean region. It may well be that the black people who brought spears tipped with it to Haiti were only Americans painted black, a common practice, and not Africans. One must also remember that Columbus's knowledge of American language was virtually non-existent. In 1464-5, El Viso de Cada Mostro wrote a description of his visit of a few years before to the West African coast. He noted that the West Africans of the Kingdom of Senegal, to Cape Verde, were using azagai, spears with worked and barbed iron heads, and that the Wolofs of Senegal obtained from Gambia curved alfanjas, swords, made of iron, semninium ako, azale, without steel. He also noted that they did not have ships, nor were any seen, but those Africans living along the river of Senegal and by the sea had some zopoli, called almadi, almadias, by the Portuguese, dugout boats, the largest of which carried only 3 or 4 men and which were used for fishing. As noted, non hanno navali ne mai la vedero, salvo depoi che hanno avuto cosciamente de portugalesi. Vero e che coloro che abitano sopra questa fiume, e alcune di quelle ci stanno el marin, hanno alcuni zopoli, cioè almadi tutte d'un legno, che portano de 3 in 4 uomini, al piao nelle maggiori, e con queste vana al volte e pascari, e passami el fiume e vano di loco a loco. Only very small armadillos were seen beyond Cabo Verde also, and this, coupled with the fact that the Cape Verde Islands were found to be uninhabited without any trace of occupancy, would seem to argue against much West African marine navigation, at least in the years 1455 to 63. The use of iron spear points also tends to argue against the accuracy of Columbus's information relative to black people reaching Haiti with spear points of a softer metal. One should note that the Africans of the Cape Verde mainland were reported as using bows and arrows, rather than spears, in the Cata Mosta narrative. It is possible that Columbus, who probably never did understand what the Americans of Haiti were saying, was confused and that the Guanan-using people were different from the black people mentioned. On the other hand, the evidence is perhaps unconvincing by and of itself. There are, however, bits and pieces of data tending to at least provide some support for West African voyages to the Americas. For example, Pedro Martir de Angleria obtained information, at second hand, to the effect that in 1513, Vasco Núñez del Balboa met members of a tribe of Ethiopians in Panama. While crossing the peninsula, Balboa reached the native village of Quirecua on the Caribbean side of the summit of the mountain and encontraron a los esclavos negros de una región que dista y Quirecua solo dos días, en cual no se crían más que negros, y estos feroces y sombramanera crueles. Piense que en otro tiempo pasaron de la Etiopía negros y robariqui, naufragando, se establecieron en aquellas montañas. Los de Quirecua tienen odios intestino con esos negros, y se esclavizan mutamantante o se matan. Thus, the Spaniards actually are said to have seen black slaves belonging to the Americans, but they learned that these slaves came from a totally black village located 2 days' journey away, and they conjectured that the blacks had come from Ethiopia, Black Africa, at some earlier date. López de Gómara also reports that when Núñez del Balboa reached Quirecua, he found algunos negros, some blacks, who were slaves of the American ruler. The Spaniards could only learn that there were men of that color close to there, with whom they had frequent war. López goes on to state that these were the first negroes which they saw in Indias, and I think that no more have been seen since. The negroes were as of Guinea. López never visited the Americas, and his 1552 work is based on reports received in Spain. Since Panama lies along the current coming westwards from Africa via Trinidad, such a journey is quite possible. On the other hand, it is perhaps more probable that these Africans were runaway slaves from Haiti who conspired with their American hosts to fool the Spaniards about their origins. It was very common for Americans to concoct stories designed to fool the Europeans, once the latter's avariciousness and imperialistic designs were understood. Runaway Africans had already joined the Americans on Haiti by 1502, and doubtless some would have tried to leave the island. Nonetheless, prevailing currents would probably have taken them towards Florida rather than towards Panama, unless they knew how to take advantage of American navigational skills. A Jesuit also makes reference in 1554 to his judgment that some Ethiopians were living beyond the Amazon River region, in Alia Parte Maris, Latin, or Na Outra Banda do Mar, Portuguese, but this was second-hand information. Moreover, black Africans are recorded as having escaped to the forest from Bahia with the help of Americans who captured a Portuguese slave ship prior to July 1559. The 1554 account may indicate that Brazilian Americans knew of the existence of Africa rather than that Africans were in America. Thus, we are left with intriguing possibilities, but with no hard evidence. Thor Heyerdahl has noted that a rubber boat was able to travel from the Canary Islands to the West Indies in recent times, but early sources tell us that the Canary Islanders had no means of navigation. Thus, one sort of evidence tends to balance out the other. We are, however, still left with a number of significant problems, such as how plants of the banana plantain family reached the Americas and West Africa, how certain species of cotton spread, whether the yam was present in the pre-Columbian Caribbean, and so on. The spread of banana plantain pacoba is of special significance, since it could not remain viable if carried in salt water. The pacoba, a banana, was clearly indigenous to South America. A Brazilian author states that, if the banana was known in Asia and Africa, what the first chroniclers called the pacoba, that is, the golden banana, was not. About 1535, a Portuguese pilot described the bananas of São Tomé Island, Africa. He states that they have commenced to plant there, and they are called abelana. Biano cominciato a piantar queia, erbe che divente in uno così grande che par abore, e fa quelle raspio modo di fichi che in Alessandria di Egitto, come o inteso chiamano muse. In detta isola la domandano abelana. In the 1520s, Leo Africanus described the Musée of Egypt, the same plant as above. A report on the Mina area, Ghana, in 1572 stated that bananas were also planted there, which in the Indies of Castilla were called plátanos, and also near the Agri, the bananas grew in thickets so that it seemed that no one had to plant them there. In Brazil, bananas and pacobas were quite important in the food supply. Bananas assadas, roasted bananas, were eaten by the Jesuits in 1561 when the wheat supply failed in Bahia, while the Jesuits at Espiritu Santo in 1562 had many fruits, especially that which is called bananas, which last all the year, and is a great aid to the sustenance of this house. When lands were donated for the College of Bahia in 1563, one of the first tasks was to plant bananas on them. In the 1580s, Gabriel Suarez de Sousa stated of Brazil, Pacaba é uma fruta natural desta terra, a qual se dá em uma vari muito mole e fácil de cortar. Na Índia chamam e estas pacabeiras figueiras e as fruto figos, e a estas pacobos chamam o gentio pacobuso, que quer dizer pacobo grande. A outra caste, que as indios chaman pacobemeren que quesar dizer pacoba pequena. Thus, Brazil had several types of native bananas called pacobas, some large and some small, the latter being the size of fingers called pacobemerum. The large pacobas were said to be known in India as figs and in Brazil as pacobutsu. Brazil also had, by the 1580s, bananas derived from São Tomé of Africa, which in India were said to be called figos de horta. Os negros de Ghana são mais aficiados a estas bananas que as pacobas, e delas usam mais suas rocas. The Negroes of Guinea preferred the São Tomé bananas to the pacobas. In the 1640s, George Margrave, the young naturalist, described the Brazilian varieties botanically. Varieties of the banana plantain family were widely dispersed throughout the Caribbean region, and descriptions of them date back to at least the 1530s. An early English visitor to Barbados, 1650s, has drawn pictures of the native varieties on that island, while an English traveler among the Miskito people of Nicaragua found in 1681 that one of their main agricultural plants was the plantain, along with the yam. The problem of the dispersal of the banana pacoba by human action demands more thorough study, but in any case, it stands as a strong argument for ancient maritime contact between the Americas and either Indonesia, Southeast Asia, Africa, or all of these. The dispersal of the sweet potato and other crops from the Americas through the Pacific stands as a related phenomenon. It should be noted that, with the exception of American plants being dispersed in the Pacific, virtually all writers dealing with the ancient diffusion of crops and other cultural influences exhibit an extraordinary anti-American bias. If a trait is, for example, found on both sides of the Atlantic, most diffusionists a priori favor an east-to-west dispersal and simply ignore any possible influences from west to east. Kidnapped Americans in Europe before 1492. In any case, Americans did not reach Europe and Africa solely by means of voluntary voyages or storm-driven adventures. European expeditions to the Americas are known to have taken thousands of Americans to the East, and some of these involuntary journeys preceded the time of Columbus. By the 9th century AD, the European frontier was advancing northwards and westwards, with Irish and Scottish hermits or monks reaching Iceland. Close behind them were Norse-speaking settlers and raiders from Norway and the various islands north of Scotland. Our knowledge of what happened in this region is shrouded in mystery because the earliest detailed sources, the Icelandic sagas, are of a much later date and are oriented towards the adventures of particular individuals only. According to the sagas, Greenland was not reached by the Norse until very late in the 10th century, being named at that time by Eric the Red. On the other hand, several bits of information might indicate earlier contact. First, a papal bull attributed to 834-5 reportedly already mentions both Iceland and Greenland. Secondly, a pale-colored woman with chestnut hair was reportedly seen among the Americans of Vinland, Newfoundland, in circa 1006. Thirdly, when the Norse reached Greenland in circa 985-6, they found both towards east and west traces of human dwellings as well as fragments of small boats made of skin and such instruments of stone, which made it clear that the same kind of people had lived or had journeyed there who had peopled Vinland and whom the Greenlanders, Norse, call Skraelings. Archaeology does not, thus far, support Inuit occupation of the south of Greenland in the 900s, although Inuits of the Dorset culture were there in earlier times. Nonetheless, the remains seen by the Norse were clearly of recent origin. This suggests that the abandonment of South Greenland by Dorset people could have been due to raiding by Norse or Celtic pirates in the years prior to 985. If so, it is conceivable that captives were carried back to Europe since both the Norse and Irish possessed slaves in that era. The Norse who settled in Greenland before AD 1000 made several journeys westward to Markland, Labrador, and Vinland, Terra Nova or Newfoundland. In 1009, they captured two young Americans in Markland and carried them away to Greenland and, in all probability, to Norway. The Norse sagas state, "Those boys they kept with them, taught them their language, and they were baptized. They gave their mother's name as Fatildi, that of the father as Uvegi." Thorfinn Karlsefni, the owner of the captives, did not stay long in Greenland, but sailed with all of his belongings directly to Norway in circa 1009, later returning to Iceland. Since the Americans were his property, and since the information about their learning to speak Norse and being baptized is recorded in an Icelandic saga, we must assume they were taken to Norway with Karlsefni, and perhaps from there to Iceland. Thus, in the year 1010 or thereabouts, we have record of the first Americans to reach northern Europe involuntarily in the late pre-Columbian period. The Norse of Greenland and Iceland thereafter made visits to Markland to obtain timber and other goods, one voyage being as late as 1347, when their very small vessel was blown from Markland to Iceland. The Greenland Norse also began having military contacts with Inuit people in Greenland in the early 1300s, and sporadic hostilities continued for a century or more. Since the Norse had a history of using Irish and Scots as slaves, we can assume that a small number of Inuit or other American captives would also be taken, even as several Norse were captured by the Inuit. It should be noted here that the 1347 wind-driven voyage of 17 or 18 Norse Greenlanders in a very small boat from the coast of Markland to Iceland, a boat that was not even equipped with an anchor, tends to reinforce the possibility that Americans in a similar-sized craft could also be storm-driven to Europe. Prevailing winds in the North Atlantic also sometimes drove Norse vessels eastwards to Ireland. In this connection, it is worth noting also that in old Shetlandic folk tales, Finns, Inuits, often arrived in those islands in the form of seals, and then casting their skins aside, became human beings. It has been suggested that this refers to the arrival of people in skin-covered kayaks. Some folklorists prefer other symbolic interpretations. In any case, the presence of Inuits in kayaks around the islands north of Britain will be discussed later. Very little information exists from the 15th century, but it appears that Norwegians captured Inuits perhaps on more than one occasion, along with one or more kayaks. Claudius Clavus Swart, a Danish geographer who drew his maps in the 1420s, places in the Greenland area, "The little pygmies, no more than 1 ell tall. I have seen them myself after they had been caught at sea in a skin boat which now hangs in Nidaros Cathedral. In the cathedral there is also a long boat of skin which was taken with the same kind of pygmies in it." A Norse report of the early 1200s also refers to the Inuit as very small people. For many years, an Inuit boat was on display in Trondheim Cathedral in Norway. Thus, most certainly, we have a record of Inuits being in Europe in the early 1400s. A century after Clavis Swart, a German, Jacob Ziegler, met some Danes and Swedes in Rome and learned about the pygmy predatores, or Inuit predators. Other European nationalities also seem to have come into contact with Americans before 1492. One author mentions a voyage to the Greenland-Labrador area in the early 1000s, allegedly made by some mariners of Friesland. They were cast on the rocks and took refuge on the coast. They saw some miserable-looking huts hollowed out in the ground, and around these cabins heaps of iron ore. But as they returned to their vessels, they saw coming out from these covered holes deformed men as hideous as devils, with bows and slings and large dogs following them. One Frisian was slain while the others escaped. Between circa 1418 and circa 1500, there is no official record of a Scandinavian ship reaching Greenland, partly due to the depopulation of Norway and Iceland carried out by the Black Death of 1348-9, which may well have spread to Greenland. After 1349, English and Scottish pirates began to raid Iceland, and Norwegian-Icelandic navigation fell into decline. Soon Basque and Portuguese vessels were joining in the exploitation of Icelandic waters. They alternately raided and traded with the Icelanders. It appears also that some ships, probably Basque or Breton, visited the surviving Norse in Greenland between 1400 and 1500, since European goods of that period have been found in South Greenland Norse archaeological sites. It is also believed by at least one historian of Greenland that Basque pirates may well have exterminated or carried off the last Norse Greenlanders in circa 1500. On the other hand, European reports had it simply that a pagan and barbarous fleet from neighboring shores had carried them off, suggesting perhaps a move to Newfoundland or Labrador. Certain Basque traditions point towards their having made contact with Newfoundland in the 1370s and Iceland by 1400. Maps of 1436 and 1448 definitely show a Stockfish Island, Codfish, a Bacalao Island, west of Ireland, which undoubtedly is the same island which later came to be known as Terra Nova or Newfoundland. Extensive pre-Columbian contact cannot be doubted, even though there are arguments as to whether Basques, Bretons, or others first reached the area. The subject is extremely interesting for several reasons, one being the possibility that captives from Newfoundland and or Greenland were carried back to the coasts of France and Spain. It seems likely that vessels from Denmark and England reached Newfoundland in the 1470s and 1480s, but as there is no mention of Americans being abducted, we shall proceed to evidence relating to captives actually being taken. In November 1494, a German, Dr. Hieronymo Munzer, wrote a letter about his impressions of Lisbon, Portugal. He reported that there were many Negri, blacks, in Lisbon, and that the King of Portugal had sons of Ethiopian kings with him for educational purposes. He also noted, Abet itum rex negros varii coloris, rufos negros et ab negros de vario idiomate, orei pasuai pretos de varios cores, ocobridaios pritusi anagrados ide linguas differentes. Thus, by late 1494, there were in Lisbon pretus or negros, blacks, non-whites, of various colors, including reddish or copper-colored people. These latter were probably Americans, perhaps brought from the West Indies by Columbus, from Brazil by an unknown Portuguese navigator, or most likely from Newfoundland. Interestingly, on January 11, 1503, a sailor from Lisbon presented for sale in Valencia, Spain, five negroes. One of them was Miguel, de 20 años de Terranova, expresado cuando era pequeño y llevada a Lisboa, donde lo botazan. In 1505 was presented also as a slave, Juan de 16 años de Terranova, no sabe si aún vivirán sus padres, cautivado cuando pequeño fue llevado a Portugal y luego a Castilla. Thus, Miguel was born in 1483 and was taken from Newfoundland to Lisbon when he was small, so probably before 1493. Juan was born in 1489 and was captured when small, so before 1499. They are among slaves from Terra Nova sold in Lisbon, Seville, and Valencia after 1500. It is well documented that in October 1501, some 50 or 60 Americans from the Newfoundland region were brought as slaves to Lisbon. This was followed by another shipload in 1502. These could be the origin of the Terra Nova slaves referred to before, except for the dates of their probable capture. Taking the Caribbean to Europe and Africa, Columbus and the slave trade. In any case, by the 1490s, Americans were appearing once again in European cities. Although Terra Nova, Newfoundland, and Greenland continued to be a source of captives from 1501 on, it is best at this point to turn away from northern waters to examine the activities of Columbus and the catastrophic slave trade in American flesh which he initiated in the Caribbean region. Columbus seems not to have been the first bearded white navigator to have reached the Caribbean region, but his immediate predecessor's name is unknown, and no record of any return voyage to European or North African waters exist. Moreover, Columbus's impact was singular in that he was, from the first, a dedicated slaver and exploiter with an extremely callous and indifferent attitude towards culturally different human beings. Columbus, on his first voyage, kidnapped at least 27 Americans, two of whom escaped, leaving a total of 25 in his hands. His attitude is expressed as follows, when, after abducting seven males, he says, "When your highnesses so command, they can all be carried off to Castile or held captive in the island itself, since with 50 men they would be all kept in subjection and forced to do whatever may be wished." Thus, at the very first island reached, Guanini, Columbus already was able to express his willingness to depopulate the entire island in order that the Americans might be sold as slaves in Europe or held as captives in their own land. This, it should be noted, is long prior to any disappointment about the failure to find gold or other riches in quantity. A month later, after capturing five boys, Columbus says, "Afterwards I sent to a house which is near, and they brought seven head of women, small and large, and three boys. I did this in order that the men might conduct themselves better in Spain, having women of their own land, because already it has many times been my business to bring men from Guinea in order that they might learn the language of Portugal, and afterwards when they had returned and they thought that use might be made of them in their own land, when they reached their own land this result never appeared. So that, having their women, they will be willing to do that which is laid upon them, and also these women will do much to teach our people their language, which is one and the same throughout these islands of India." After two boys escaped, Columbus stated, "And I have no great confidence in them, because many times they have attempted to escape." His philosophy of conquest and colonialism was extremely well developed. "And they are fitted to be ruled and to be set to work, to cultivate the land and to do all else that may be necessary, and you may build towns and teach them to go clothed and to adopt our customs. Also, they would make good and industrious servants." After learning of the existence of so-called cannibal, Carib groups in the Indies, Columbus began to emphasize the enslavement of the latter. While still at sea, on his first return voyage, Columbus advocated the capture of Caribs. "Very fierce people and well-proportioned and of very good understanding, who, after being removed from their inhumanity, we believe will be better than any other slaves whatsoever." On January 30, 1494, he addressed to the Spanish monarchs a plan for sending men, women, and children to Spain to learn the Castilian language and to be trained in service, with more care than other slaves receive, saying that this plan would save a great number of souls while at the same time providing the colonizing Spaniards with the profit needed to supply themselves with goods. In other words, Columbus proposed, after his first voyage, that American slavery be used to finance the conquest. Subsequently, Columbus began to enslave Taino, Arawak people who were definitely not cannibalistic, and would appear that the idea of punishing Caribs, for being allegedly so, was simply an expedient financial strategy. The logic of his activities was well expressed by Las Casas, who noted that El acabara en muy poco tiempo de consumir toda la gente de esta isla, Haití, porque tenía determinado de cargar los navios que veniesen de Castilla des esclavos y enviarlos a vender a las islas de Canarias, y de los Azores y a las de Cabo Verde, y a donde quiera que bien se vendiesen. Y sobre esta mercadería fundaba principalmente los aprovechamientos para suplir los dichos gastos y excusar a los reos de casta, como en principal granjería. Thus Columbus, according to Las Casas, was determined to consume the entire population of Haiti by filling every ship with slaves to be sold in the Canary, Azores, and Cabo Verde Islands or wherever, and planned that these slaves would finance the conquest. As Las Casas points out, for Columbus, the lives of Americans were obviously nothing, and the continuous wars to obtain slaves were simply necessary to fill the ships. Columbus wrote to the monarchs that from Haiti, "It is possible, in the name of the Holy Trinity, to send all the slaves which it is possible to sell, of whom, if the information which I have is correct, they tell me that one can sell 4,000, and certainly the information seems authentic, because in Castile and Portugal and Aragon and Italy and Sicily and the islands of Portugal and Aragon and the Canaries, they utilize many slaves, and I believe that those from Guinea are not now enough. In any case, there are these slaves in Brazil wood, which seem a live thing, profitable, and still gold." Thus, even as Columbus was loading 5 ships with slaves, he was proposing to sell 4,000 in various parts of the Mediterranean and along the coast of Africa. Columbus was also one concerned that many Americans would die in the slave trade because, as he said, the blacks and the native Canary Islanders when first enslaved also had died in great numbers. For Columbus, the Americans were piezas, pieces, or cabezas de cabras, heads of goats, and it did not matter if only 10% lived to reach a market, according to Las Casas, who incidentally possessed Columbus's diaries, letters, and notes. The shipment of Americans to Europe and Africa by Columbus, and by other Spaniards, was, then, not an accident, nor was it a result of armed resistance or alleged cannibalism. It was a direct extension of the style of commercial slavery long practiced by the Genoese and Venetians in the Mediterranean and used by the Portuguese along the west coast of Africa. Columbus's voyages, in a very real sense, were mere extensions of the old galley routes from Italy to North Africa and the Black Sea, or of Portuguese routes along the African coast. What was the result? First, many thousands of Americans were shipped to Spain during Columbus's period of dominance in the Caribbean. It is difficult to calculate the exact number because many ships departed from Haiti without leaving any record of their cargo, but we may be sure that they did not leave empty. On the very first voyage, although Columbus only carried 25, it is likely that Martin Alonso Pinzon, who sailed to Galicia and then to Palos separately, may have carried more. It is possible that Pinzon actually landed the first Americans in Spain a few days before Columbus arrived in Lisbon. In any case, at least 3,000 Americans are known to have been shipped to Europe between 1493 and 1501, with the likely total being possibly double that. Most were sent to the Seville area, where they seem to show up in the slave markets as Negros, without a place of origin being mentioned. Others were probably sold in the Azores and other islands, partly to avoid the wrath of Queen Isabel, who on occasion expressed hostility towards the dividing up of her vassals without her prior permission. Columbus reached Lisbon in early March 1493. Many people came to see the captive Americans, and it is very likely that some of the latter were taken 9 leagues into the interior to see the King of Portugal. There it was that 2 Americans drew maps which showed of the Lucayos, Bahamas, Cuba, Haiti, and other islands. It may be also that Columbus left some Americans with the Portuguese, as discussed earlier. Shortly thereafter, some of the Americans were taken to Seville, perhaps 7 to 10 being still alive and together. Some were left in that area, while about 6 or 7 were taken overland across Spain to Barcelona, where they were displayed before the monarchs in mid-April. In the fall of 1493, some Americans were taken on Columbus's second westward voyage, but only two of these reportedly arrived alive. One was able to run away immediately upon landing in Haiti. The process whereby Columbus began loading ships with slaves need not concern us here in any detail. The flavor of it is conveyed by a report of Miguel de Cunha, a member of the second expedition. When our caravels were to leave for Spain, we gathered 1,600 male and female persons of those Indians, and of these we embarked in our caravels on February 17, 1495, 550 souls among the healthiest. For those who remained, we let it be known in the vicinity that anyone who wanted to take some of them could do so, to the amount desired, which was done. And when each man was thus provided with slaves, there still remained about 400, to whom permission was granted to go where they wished. Among them were many women with children still at suck. Since they were afraid that we might return to capture them once again, they left their children and began to flee like desperate creatures. About 200 died on the voyage and were cast into the ocean, the rest being disembarked in Spain. Columbus gave to Cunha a very beautiful Carib woman. Cunha says, "I conceived the desire to take my pleasure with her." She valiantly resisted Cunha's efforts at rape, but eventually he had his way, after thrashing her mercilessly. Thus the veil of evil descended upon the Caribbean and many long years of rape and genocide commenced. As Todorov has stated, the 16th century perpetrated the greatest genocide in human history. In 1500, the world population is approximately 400 million, of whom 80 million inhabit the Americas. By the middle of the 16th century, out of these 80 million, there remain 10. If the word genocide has ever been applied to a situation with some accuracy, this is here the case. But the tens of millions of Americans who disappeared after 1492 did not all die in the Holocaust inflicted within the Americas. Many thousands were sent to Europe and Africa, where their descendants still live. 2. The intensification of contacts, transatlantic slavery and interaction, after 1500. The arrival of American slaves in Spain and Portugal. It will perhaps be surprising to some listeners to learn that the greatest degree of intensive contact between Americans and Africans did not occur initially in either the Americas or Africa, but rather in European cities such as Lisbon, Seville, and Valencia. This contact has not heretofore been studied for a variety of reasons, one of the principal ones being the myth that the enslavement of Americans was a temporary phenomenon. Another reason, equally mythical, is the notion that in modern times slavery and Negro slavery were virtually synonymous concepts. Slavery was quite common in the Mediterranean world in the 13th and 14th centuries. In Iberia, Islamic laws recognized slavery, and Muslims were even allowed to hold other Muslims as slaves if the latter were black or luru, of intermediate color. In Christian Barcelona, one finds numerous slaves between 1275 and 1288 classified as muru lorum, Muslim of intermediate color, Saraceno blanco, white Saracen, Saracenum nigrium, black Saracen, Saracenum lorum, Saracen of intermediate color, and Saracenum album, white Saracen. In the 13th century, Barcelona had many Tartaros, Tartars, Greeks, Bulgarians, Bosnians, Albanians, and so on as slaves, including an Esclava Blanca Tartara, white Tartar slave. In the 14th century, Muslim slaves became more common again, and one finds many white, luru, intermediate, and black slaves. In 1439, Simon, an Ethiopian slave, killed a Russian, Russo slave. Turkish and Tartar slaves were also present, along with many Russians, Bulgarians, Sarts, probably Sardos or Sardinians, and others called Abguas, Circasses, Circassians, and so on, probably from the Caucasus Mountains. In 1429, two runaway black slaves were recaptured in Redon, France, but others escaped to Tolosa, Toulouse, where slavery was not recognized. Between 1243 and 1296, of 50 slaves listed in Barcelona, 18% were Laros, 10% were black, 20% were Saracen only, and about 52% were blanche, white. In Provence, a Saracen noir, un esclavo blanc, un fia sarkisian, and un garçon turc were all sold as slaves in the 15th century. This characterizes slavery in the period, with white, black, and brown, European, African, and Asian slaves being treated basically the same, and with a tremendous ethnic variety, although most were from the Balkans, the Black Sea region, or northern Africa. In 1266-71, several olivestri, olive-colored, slaves were sold in Genoa, while of 48 slaves named between 1401 and 1499 in that city, 25 were albi, white, 15 neri, black, 6 olivigni, intermediate or olive, 1 indenco, indigo or Indian, and 1 loro, intermediate or brown. There were many Tartar and other Eastern slaves in Italy during that period, along with a substantial number of blacks and others from North Africa and the Iberian Peninsula. In Portugal, slaves of Muslim background were present in the 13th century, along with some who were Mozarabes, Christians who lived in an Arab fashion. During the 14th century, Portuguese vessels began to raid the Canary Islands, and many Canarios were introduced as captives, along with additional Muslims. In the 15th century, Berber and Black Senegalese, Wolof, slaves became common, especially after 1440-50. During certain periods, the term Saraceni was synonymous with Siwi or Captiwi, slave or captive. Morris, Moor, corresponded to a free or slave Muslim, while later slaves were known as Negro Igini Preto e Sobretudo Escravo. Thus, slaves as a class might be called, depending on the time period, Saraceni, or Negro, or Preto, or Slave, Slav. Quite early, in both Portugal and Spain, the status of a child was determined by the status of the mother. If the mother was a slave, the child was also a slave. In the Western Mediterranean, the slave trade was dominated by the Genoese and Castilians by means of slave factors in Fez, Morocco, but slaves from the caste were also introduced. In 1455, for example, a Tartar slave was mentioned in Seville. At about that time, however, the Portuguese began to dominate the Black African trade by successfully reaching Agadir and then Senegal in the mid-15th century. In 1452, Pope Nicholas V permitted the Portuguese to enslave infidels, pagans, and enemies of Christ. By 1479, the Portuguese were dominant insofar as black slaves were concerned, but Canario and Muslim slaves continued to be obtained by the Spanish directly. For a long period of time, Muslim slaves continued to arrive in Seville and other Spanish cities, some from Granada and others from Algiers, Oran, and other places which were raided in North Africa. Canary Islanders were also shipped in by the Spaniards who had replaced the Portuguese as the oppressors of the Canarios. Thus, all during the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries, the slaves of the Iberian Peninsula were of all colors and of many nationalities, including Greeks, Slavs, Turks, Egyptians, Asians, Indians, Americans, and so on. A Portuguese expedition to the Gambia in 1457 took with it an Indian interpreter, Jacob. The Christian Castilians possessed slaves of many kinds in the 13th and 14th centuries, most of whom were Mores, Moros, or Moresno, children of Moros, perhaps Moreno. Some were classified by color, white, black, luru, as in Catalunya, while a few in 1266 were called Mamelukes, slave in Arabic, especially soldier slaves. In 1475, a royal order established for Seville the position of Mayoral y juez de todos los negros y loros, libres y captivos que están y son captivos y oros en la Sevilla, y en todo su arzobispado, y que no pueden facer nanfagan los dichos negros y negras, y loros y loras, ninguna fiestas ni juzgados de entre ellos, sevo ante vos el dicho Juan de Valladolid, negro nuestra juez y mayoral de los dichos negros, loros y loras, y mandamos que vos conozcáis de los debates y pleitos y casamientos, y non otro alguno, por cuanto sois persona suficiente para ello, y nos somos informados que eso es de linaje noble entre los dichos negros. Thus, in 1475, Juan de Valladolid, a black of noble ancestry, was appointed as the judge and mayor of the blacks and loros, browns of the Seville area, with authority over their communal life, whether they were free or slave. This policy of self-government for blacks and browns conformed to the established Castilian and Aragonese policies toward free Muslim and Jews, each community of which had its own laws and courts separate from those of the Christian community. This attitude of tolerance and autonomy was later abolished, but it set a direct precedent for later policies favoring American autonomous pueblos in the Americas after the 1520s. In any case, American slaves were probably integrated into the non-white community structure in Seville. Thus, the arrival of American captives after 1493 did not, in any sense, present a new spectacle. Both Spaniards and Portuguese had become accustomed to financing their wars and expeditions by seizing men, women, and children wherever possible. This is not to say that it was at all clear that all such captives were legal slaves, especially if they were not taken in just war, but, in practice, laws were often ignored. One finds, for example, Christians captured by Muslims being treated as slaves in Spain if purchased from Muslim slave dealers. In the records which have been published from Seville and Valencia, possession seems initially to have always been accepted as proof of the rights to sell a slave and for the authorities to impose a tax on the sale. Columbus was the major supplier of American slaves prior to 1500. As noted earlier, he caused some 3,000 to perhaps 6,000 slaves to be sent to Europe and also, if we are to believe that his plans were implemented to the Azores, Canary, Madeira, and Cabo Verde Islands. By the year 1500, however, a great escalation began in the shipment of Americans across the Atlantic since other Spaniards and the Portuguese became directly active. In the year 1500, Americans were directly transported to Europe from the Caribbean islands, from the coasts of South America, and from the Terra Nova, Newfoundland region. Three major new sources of slaves were thus opened up, and it is necessary to examine this subject before proceeding to an analysis of what happened to the Americans when they arrived in eastern islands. As mentioned before, Gaspar Corte-Real and João Fernandes were among Portuguese navigators from the Azores who reached the Newfoundland-Greenland area in 1500 or perhaps earlier. Fernandes may have taken captives to the Azores, but if so, no record exists. In October 1501, however, Corte-Real sent some 57 captives to Lisbon. Their description is worth noting. Les habitants sont un peu plus grands que nous. Ils sont très semblables et des cigans. Leur visage est peint et manière des Indiens. Quelqu'un évoque six signes. D'autres évoquent huit au moins. Les chevaux de mêle sont longs et flottants en boucle. L'urio de couleur préverte. La femme, le couleur est plutôt blanche. Le mâle, au contraire, est beaucoup plus foncé. Thus, the Americans were slightly taller than the European observers. They resembled gypsies with their faces marked in signs like those of the Indians. The hair of the males, who were darker than the females, was long and curly, and their eyes were greenish in color. Thus, it is quite possible that these Americans were part Norse Greenlander or part Breton or Basque. We do not know exactly where these green-eyed Americans came from, whether from Newfoundland or Labrador. However, they were in possession of what appeared to be part of a sword and jewelry manufactured in Italy. This tends to confirm early contact with Europe, as discussed before. In 1501, Miguel Corte-Real sailed back to the Terra Nova region, where he disappeared. One of his ships returned to Portugal with certain men and women whom he found. In 1503, the Portuguese sent out two ships, and thereafter the Newfoundland area was visited regularly, so much so that in 1506 a royal tax was imposed on the fishing catch. The Bretons, English and perhaps Basques, were also active in the area, but that will be discussed later. Slaves from Terra Nova show up in the slave markets of Seville and Valencia very soon after 1500. In Valencia, during the period to 1516, we find in 1503 Miguel, age 20, and Man, age 10, in 1505, Juan, 16, and Pedro, 16. In 1507, Antonio, 8, and Juana Marco, 18. In 1515, Ali, now Melchor, 20. In 1516, Catalina, 28. These eight slaves were, with one exception, all obtained from Portuguese sources. They were all classified as Negroes, with the exception of Juan and Pedro, called simply slaves. In Seville, between 1510 and 1515, some 13 Terranova slaves were registered and sold, including, in 1510, Isabel, age 20, Cristobal, age 20, Virgida, 17, in 1511, Pedro, 20, Anton, 25, Felipa, 14, in 1512, Pedro, 25, Catalina, 18, Anton, 25, in 1513, Fernando, 20, and Maria, 25, in 1514, Francisca, 14, and in 1515, Maria, 20. Two of these slaves were categorized as Negro, one as Loru, and 10 as slaves only. In 1525, a Spaniard, Esteban Gomez, made a voyage up the Atlantic coast of North.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.